by night and said to him, Rabbi, great teacher, we know that you are teacher was come from God. For no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. The second verse of this third chapter of John is within the context of understanding a wonderful dialogue between a guy called Nicodemus and another fellow called Jesus of Nazareth. I want you to write down this topic for today. Turning up the dimmer of worship. Turning up the dimmer of worship. Now some of you will know what a dimmer is. You know what a dimmer switch is? Okay, three people. Okay, this is what a dimmer is. Dimmers are devices used to lower the brightness of a light. So when you go to a house, you're going to see a switch sometimes. It has a little lever on it. Sometimes the light goes down and go up. It goes down and go up. You got the picture? Yeah. You know you got that? Praise the Lord. Now, watch this. By changing the voltage waveform applied to the lamp, talk to the physics people about that. You know what that means? It is possible to lower the intensity of the light output. You got that? You got that right? Everybody got that?
Yeah.
So, okay, I'll explain it again. So, this is what a dimmer experience is, and what you ought to do in your life is to increase your understanding of the dimmer, and once you reach a full potential of worship, you get rid of the dimmer. Because you can't be going around down no more. You gotta stay up! Worship is serious business by their friends in Christ. When we look at the behavior of Nicodemus, Nicodemus was a fella who had to go by night. He was ashamed. Why? Because he was a big time. He was a member of the Sanhedrin, the Council of 70 Jews and priests and scribes. They were the top echelon of society. They were the aristocrats. They supposedly knew it all. Why would he go to an itinerant or a place-to-place preacher, a rabbi guy, and ask for knowledge? You see, if he went publicly, he would be probably stoned or excommunicated or fired from his job. You know, we hate to get fired from our jobs. The severance pay only lasts a period of time. And so he wants to be a part of the Sanhedrin, but he went to Jesus by night. What is so powerful is that he said a very astounding thing. He said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. Just a member of the Sanhedrin now. For no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Do you have favor in your life? You have favor in your life. Goodness and mercy, this is not in your favor, right? Mercy and goodness will follow you all the days of your life. And you will dwell in the house of the Lord forever, says the psalmist, when you have favor. And so what was happening here was that Nicodemus, although being a part of the Sanhedrin, the Council of 70 Jews, he had a void in him. He had a sense of an incompleteness. And so he needs to be filled with the understanding of an awesome God. And he heard about Jesus. And so he had to do a special rendezvous, a special meeting, a special time to encounter a man who seems to have all of the answers. Jesus is the answer for this world today. And Nicodemus realized it many, many, many years ago. And so he has to have consultation. He has to have a dialogue with Jesus. Have a little talk with Jesus, my friends in Christ. As we celebrate this most holy feast called Trinity Sunday, we see the wonderful manifestation of God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Many persons don't understand why we have this particular feast. But it brings to the wonderful tying together the whole experience of God. That the God from the very, very beginning of time saw it fitting to create us. He saw it fitting to bring us to the whole trials and tribulations of his only begotten son called Jesus of Nazareth, who was given a name Joshua, who was given a name Emmanuel. What's the other names we have for Jesus? Come on now, good church people. For Jesus now. Job was named given to God and his completeness as God the Father. Give me some other names. Come on, smart people. Help me out. Teacher, what else? The righteous one, the holy one, the Messiah of God, Rabbi, what else? But anyway, I know it's you're tired, I don't know. But the whole aspect is that I want you to realize that Jesus is the embodiment. He is the personification of the most holy and blessed Trinity. He is God in the flesh, our incarnate Lord. And so, through this whole aspect of the Trinity, he operates a certain way. Let me just explain the Trinity in 45 words or less. The Trinity talks about God manifesting himself, but of the same essence and being. And so what God would do, he has manifested himself as a Father, as a soul provider, as a Son, as a Redeemer or Sanctifier, as God the Holy Spirit, as a Paraclete, as a Counselor, as a Guide, as a close friend. You got that? God in his functionality is three, but God in his essence of being is one. So there's not three gods, but one God. Let me use myself, I am God now, so don't get confused. Don't tell the bishop I say I'm God. But listen to this. I manifest myself in three ways. First of all, I am a priest. And charge is in George, at least for the time being. Okay? Now watch this now. My role is to be a spiritual leader, director, to help things out and all this wonderful thing. We have a wonderful relationship with the vestry and the people, and most people like me, most. So, no, that's all right. And so the whole aspect is that I have a function, okay? And so my function is I function as capacity. I wear all these GQ clothes. I look good today, don't I? I don't look as good as Barbara. But that's all right. And so the whole aspect is that I function a certain way. But watch it. When I go home, see that lovely lady from North Vegas, Dion, Denise? That's my wife. Now, when we get in the car, it's a different story. She respects me, but she don't necessarily cares whether I'm a priest or not. I'm a hubby, and this is what she tells me, Barbara, what she tells me, she say, I was dressed a certain way, she say, you won't go on a dress like that. So I'm going to turn back around and go change my clothes, because that's, we have that declaration, so in that manifestation, I am the husband. And she's a wife, so we have that relationship. There's still another boy who have this cookie, illegally in church. That's my son, Brennen. And Brennen can care less where I'm a priest. He's going to know when daddy coming back down from this strange box of all these clothes to come down and give him a hug and give him one of those 100% Jews. That's what he interested in. He didn't enter that. And so, and he don't call me, honey. He said, if he come up, he say, honey, how you doing? No, my son, don't call me, honey. She'll call me, honey. The other private names we can't mention at church. But let me tell you something. He just wants to daddy. That's what he interested in. And so I manifest myself differently to him. But guess what? I'm the same one dude. And what happens here is that as we try to understand our God says, you know what, I'll show myself to you in three different ways. When it comes to Jesus and his understanding of God the Father, Jesus is like the undercover boss. Whereby he is in the system. He was in the world, but he's not of the world. And so what he did was he showed us how we ought to operate. That was the undercover boss one too. That's what on CBS or ABC? CBS, usually. And what's so interesting about it is that an undercover boss would do things for a period of time, and then at a particular time, call the boy in. You see, the undercover boss is to see what's going on. That's what Jesus said. That's why he came. He came in a lowly state to see how we treat people at the bottom. He was born to a pure virgin who was married to Joseph. Joseph is doing to the Mary, no, perhaps Jesus, no. And so it was a strange situation. So a sense of illegitimacy was surrounding Jesus, you know. You ever realize that? And so Jesus came into this world. He wasn't born and no birth in sweet. He was born where? Outside. And so to the Holy Spirit, experience, he went to this whole understanding of growing up and getting shamed, and there were certain stigmas that were attached. And then also he became this wonderful rabbi and going through all these portions. You know what? The Son of Man would suffer many things and then die after 3 days rise again. But you know his disciples didn't believe that. Said, absolutely not. But to the whole thing Jesus went through it, he showed himself a certain way. But you know, it's quite interesting when you go home, I want you to reread John 14:28b, where Jesus said, the Father is greater than I. He said, so you know. You know why? In his functionality. He was functioning a certain way. And so when the undercover boss goes to his own company, he becomes an employee. And he sits there and works with the system. So in his functionality, he's subordinate to the boss, but he's also the boss. And so I want you to understand that's how we can look at the understanding of the Holy and Blessed Trinity. The Spirit of God is the other advocate. Jesus was the first advocate. The other advocate was God, the Holy Spirit, who comes to be another voice for us. That's what's so powerful about the understanding of the Holy and Blessed Trinity. The word Trinity does not appear nowhere in the Holy Scriptures. Why? Because the doctrine must understand how God operates and functions. And so the theologians of all, especially the apostles and the patristic fathers, that's the person in the first and second century, they came together to say, no, what we need to make sure people understand who God is, because there's lots of heresy out there. And so we see God in a wonderful way. And so when you look at Matthew 28, in particular the 19th verse, a part of the Great Commission, Jesus told his disciples, you go there and baptize all nations in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Remember, I'll be with you always, even to the end of the ages. And many portions of scripture you're going to find, especially in the pastoral letters of the Pauline authors. That's those wonderful books like Galatians, and Ephesians, and Philippians, and Colossians, and Corinthians. All those 14 epistles. Many of them either begin or end with the understanding of the Trinitarian understanding of God. You and I must understand that there's another, there's a really powerful word. I go in deep water, I don't go in shallow waters, I go in deep water now. It's a word called perichoresis. What on God's green earth is he talking about? The word is spelled P-E-R-I. C-H-O-R-E-S-I-S. When we're in seminary, we're going to understand the perichoresis of the Trinity, which means in English, the mutual penetration, the diffusion, the flowing or transmission of persons who work together. Perichoresis. And it has to do with this. It refers to the manner in which the three persons of the Trinity relate to each other. Now watch this. When Jesus was on the cross, he communicated with God the Father, and he's able to do things with the power of the Holy Spirit. Notice that. The Trinitarian understanding is always there. At the beginning of creation, God created the heavens and earth. How? Through the efficacy, through the effectiveness and the efficiency of God the Holy Spirit. And the wind blew on the earth, and the breath of God breathed on the breath of God, the Son, when it said, has it through the power of the Holy Spirit. And when Jesus, he said, into your hands I command my spirit, and he gave up the ghost. Who's the ghost? The Holy Spirit. Where the Holy Spirit went? The God the Father. Now watch it, the power of the Holy Spirit was able to help to the understanding of Jesus who ascended to the land of Sheol and Hades, or the land of silence. You know Jesus went to hell, right? He had to go to hell. So when someone tells us to go to hell, you need to know what that is. Jesus went there already. Okay, he went to the land of the dead. And the redeemed person is there too, they had a chance to know the story of Jesus. Okay, well, I said. And so the operation of perichoresis has to do with the interconnectivity of God all around. That's why from time to
time when the wife and I have conversation, watch us now, watch a Trinitarian understand me.
You know me, God, don't get me wrong now.
Okay. And so she said, you know what, Scott, I want you to tell me more about this portion of scripture. And so I put the priestly hat on. Watch it now. And so when we talk for too long, Kurt's going to start to scream.
Oh, he can scream.
And so all of a sudden I got to go, I got to tend to him. And I got in order to keep him quiet, you know what, I got to go preaching people to him, you know, and to sing a song.
There's a friend for little children above the bridegroom's side.
I know it, not because of anything, because I'm a priest. And so from time to time, when he's going to a lot, I got to do the sign of the cross on him. When he comes up with his blessing, his bread you're thirsty.
Anybody to pay for that party.
And so, all of a sudden, it's just a perfect rose. And the family's performing at the top of the wife about the money because that's her role as a parent. So they need. And you know what? So I said, dear God, help me through this situation. So you're going to see the perichoresis, the operation, where you have this wonderful synergy. You have this interconnectivity. You have this symbiotic relationship. You see how important it is? To be dependent on each other. Because that was strong $80. I need $300. Where is it? Is it worse? So I have to pay it to death. God, help us all about. Become a priest again in the car. And I give the wife, she goes to me the same time, and I pray and say, hey, honey, what's going on? You doing okay? You say, she said, you have $20. I said, $20. And then finally, $20, the wife asks him for a $20. And the child screaming, so then she said, okay, then buy the milk. But you don't know that info broke cost $18.97. So what happened is the backwards and forwards, and so God operates like that. Whereby three in one and one in three. Although I'm the same person in essence and in being, I function three separate ways. And that's the whole wonderful understanding. Some people use the one aspect of a solid, water, and vapor. That the ice is a form of water. The vapor is part of water, and the liquid part of it is a form of water too. And so it is in three different forms, but yet the same essence and being. You and I need to understand the perichoresis of God and how we connect with each other. And so as we try to understand this experience, there's a challenge for us today. And the challenge simply is this. You ready for this? Light up your worship experience. Light up your worship experience. Now what has happened here in this church, if you haven't realized it, we put extra lights in. You know what I'm saying? It seemed a little brighter. Why? Because I thought I had eye problems. So I went to the doctor. The doctor said, no, Father, you have no eye problem. You just need to be in more light. I said, wow, I'm a child. They're like, so no matter where I go, even if the power turns off, I have my light, baby. I'm a child. They're like, when the power goes off, you know the family say, wow, I know. You know what I'm saying? I know hubby has it. I know the children say, I know daddy has a light. I say, always, baby, I always have a light. I never in the darkness. And that's the understanding of the light up your worship experience. That's why I want you to get rid of the dim experience. Three in one and one in three. Dimly we worship. We are so worship dimly, but bright the vision that delighted. You know the song? Bright the vision that delighted. I love stuff like that because it tells us what we need to do in our worship experience. Now, I want you to write that. You know that after that, come in. Oh, yes, baby, come in. I want you to write the word light. L-I-G-H-T, light. Light up your worship experience. The L stands for listen up. The I stands for inch up. The G stands for get up. The A stands for hand up. And the T stands for talk up. What am I talking about? First of all, to listen up is to have the cutting edge of worship. Listen up to the cutting edge of the worship experience. What do I mean? If you realize it by now, our worship experience can be enhanced by certain things. Some persons don't like no praise team. If I'm your priest, that's one thing I want to implement. We're going to have a praise team, whereby you're going to have the feeling and notion of worship, whereby you're going to have persons in a very tasteful way browse up the wonderful convocation with a praise to our God. Because if you can praise your politician, you can boogie down and praise for your NBA team, you can praise God even more. Praise God and praise God in this house of worship. So what we need to do is to listen up to the cutting edge. It's happening, it's so good, it enhances the worship experience. You praise and then you go into the worship. Now technically, because people say it's a praise worship team, not really, you know. It's just a praise team. And a praise team brings in the last worship song to bring in the frame mind of what we deal with here. The sacramentality of God's church. We don't worship idols, we don't do nonsense here. What we do is that we live out the gospel message and dramatization. And we are sad to the place because I hell don't want to stop. That'd be a scary thing, you know. And so your praise must be connected to your worship. What do you understand me? The second understanding is inch up. What am I talking about? Inch up to the plate and back for Jesus. You need to be a defender of the faith. I don't know, Bush. Oh, I'm Anglican. Oh, yeah, I'm Anglican. Yeah. No. You need to be a Christian, most importantly. Whether you're Church of God or Baptist, it's irrelevant to God, you know. Those things are important, you know. It's how you live your life. Are you a defender of the faith? People say, oh, I've been around and you've been doing nonsense for all these years. You just go to the motion, you're still wicked and evil as ever when you leave church. Stop it! Be a Christian, whereby you have a relationship with God, even when you party it. I enjoy the party. And it's good to be a part of the experience and celebrate. But you see, through it all, I'm still Christian, you know. I listen to some of the songs and Mr. Perry Bellows and say it to you, you know, all the songs, you know, the lyrics, you can say the song. You know what I mean? No great dancers now, I understand. But the whole aspect is to just enjoy the whole experience. Nothing wrong with that. Well, I don't know what you say, okay, well, I like that song. Okay? And so the whole aspect is that we are in the world, but what we're not of the world. So, thank God you're on a very safe party to the point where I say everything went well. You got no strange guests here, no strange things, right? No, you had a wonderful time, beautiful old time songs, and some contemporary songs. So bridging the old with the new. Oh, it is so good to be a part of the experience. But we have to defend the faith against all odds because many persons have strayed away from God. I've done nonsense. I've seen many persons who have gone to Rastafarianism. They've gone to Islam. They just moved away from God. They used to come to these churches too. You know, it's amazing when we see people when we walk about and see the things that people are involved in. There's a high rate of suicide in the Bahamas. Great sense. We think that our life belongs to us to be undertaken. What nonsense? Why do we come to the point of desperation when we have such an awesome God and all these churches all around? We need to catch ourselves and see how serious it is to defend the face of into the plate and back. Get a home run, hit the home run. I just get struck up sometimes, and that's all right. But my aim is to hit a home run. The third understanding is to get up and get involved with your church ministry. So many people like to criticize. I don't like that. I don't like that. I don't like that. You always criticize it. Be a part of the solution, not part of the problem. Amen. Get up and help out. Yes. Is that the same thing you're saying? Why? Because some of you, some of you all do not step up and do what you have to do. So I say, get up off of your part of your body. You know what I'm saying? and be a part of the solution and help your church grow and get stronger. Fourthly, hand up to the people in distress and not just give them a hand out. Hand up to the people in distress and don't just give them a hand out. What has happened is that some person, and this is a problem in Iceland, America, let me tell you something. I think some persons are in need, don't get me wrong. But some people are poor, because they make poor decisions. All of them carry no blame. I dealt with a particular lady in one jurisdiction, not here though. And she said, Father, I can't pay my mortgage. I said, look, well, makes good. Many other people can't pay their mortgage, but she wants some assistance from the church. Watch this now. I go to Wunga's apartment. Those I just said, right? You cannot pay a mortgage, you go to the hotel apartment. I funded that for a period of time. I went to a house. My TV is that size. My TV is that size. TV. Why? She watched HBO and Showtime. I am basic. She have designer buys. Designer shoes, designer clothes. She can't pay. All right, that's what they know, mortgage. She got to pay rent. And that's where you have your priorities in the wrong place. I see you have a body on sale. They'll have a TV that's worth, that's what, you know, the special ones like, it's a round sound. That's nonsense. You have to work, and then some people, and you all know the girl that was sick of eating. You know, somebody's betraying you, you know, that trickster shit. But they trick you. They're doing nonsense. Now, see, I'm not saying help people, don't get me wrong, but some people are poor because of poor decisions. And in the 90s of America, what has happened was that persons on welfare for years and years and years and years. You mean to tell me after 1 or 2 years you're still on welfare? Why are you welfare for 56 years? Generationally, you have a generational curse. Stop that. Break that cycle of poverty. You can do what you know. But you have to get your life together. So whether this give people a hand out, I'm giving them a hand. I say, you know what? We're going to work along with you. We're going to help you out. Somebody give me a story. Y'all know what it is. This is fair. Some give the same story. Over and over again. One guy in another jurisdiction tell me, you know what? I have 7 children and I have a conversation. He had 4. Why is it happening to the other 3? So they give you a story. And you know, you're stuck at the answer. You won't get no help because God can hear you. Try to change your life. Hand up one another, hand out. And then the last one. Talk up. Talk of the saving power of the gospel message of God wherever you go. Talk about it. What we do here in this church on the 14th of March 2018, we instituted a community walk about.